Did you know that you can parameterize your notebooks in Azure Data Studio for Python as well as other kernels like PowerShell? Learn more in this episode of Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Aaron Nelson. Aaron, thanks for joining us again today.
Thanks for having me back, Hannah.
Yeah, always a pleasure to have you on the show. And today we're going to be talking about automation and parameterization using Azure Data Studio. And parameterization to Azure Data Studio notebooks is something that's relatively new. So I'd love, Aaron, if you can tell our viewers a little bit about it, why it exists, how to use it, and then maybe show us a cool demo.
Sure, absolutely. So, you know, notebooks, Jupyter Notebooks have been gaining popularity in the SQL community, PowerShell community, all, you know, through .NET communities. It's always been a big thing in other communities, but now we're, you know, taking on and learning a lot about it. And as we're progressing on that journey, you know, people have learned the basics of Jupyter Notebooks and then Jupyter Books. And now there's times where this ability to mix the documentation and the code into one, you know, single file that you can hand someone is terrific. You know, if you're handing it off to someone who maybe is starting out, like a new developer in your group, and they need to set up their environment so that they can code just as efficiently as everyone else, these are terrific. But then you get into certain scenarios where you need to build something out and you need to do it repeatedly. Maybe you're setting up some automated testing. You know, maybe you're just trying to recreate a scenario or just trying to build things out in a build pipeline, all kinds of uses. But at the end of the day, you need to be able to repeat and repeat what you're doing. Sometimes you need to spin up five of these things and they each need to have a different name. And that's great, except your notebooks previously in Azure Data Studio didn't have this ability to accept a new name and, like, you know, for you to be able to tell it what the name was. So with parameterization, we're able to tell it, hey, here's your name, and go on to the next step and run with that.
Awesome. It's pretty cool capability. And, you know, of course, I'm a huge fan of notebooks and Python and that sort of thing. But I think today you're actually going to show us how to do it in another language.
That's right. Yes, we have the availability to do it with Python. We can do these parameters with T-SQL. And today I'm actually going to show you how to do it with PowerShell, one of the options that you've got available to you. So if we want to go over and take a look, first thing I figure is probably relevant to start at the docs page. So if you need some more information, a link for this will be down in the show notes that you can take a look at how to set up your parameterization inside of Azure Data Studio. Honestly, it's pretty straightforward. You just come over here into Azure Data Studio. When you find a cell that you want to make into a parameterized cell, you just come in here, you hit the ellipsis, and you take it, tell it that you want to make it a parameter cell. It's as easy as that. From there, depending on what technology you're using to inject the parameters, it may not even need to have the parameters right there in that cell declared. It could be later on the script that they get picked up and used. That's actually going to be the case with what we're looking at here today. For this first little demo that I want to give you, we're going to take a look at just really quickly building out a SQL on Docker instance and being able to spin it up and give it a port number and an SSH password. And as you can see down here in the bottom, I've got everything set up for this. I'm going to execute my notebook down here. It might be hard to see in the highlighting. And I'm going to pass it some parameters, one of which is my SSH password, and the second of which is going to be a string that's going to be used as my port number. And because I deal with a lot of Docker instances, it's also going to be my container name, part of my container name as well. So when I want to go ahead and do that, all I have to do is go ahead and run this. That's going to kick it off. While this is working, it's really just coming in here and working on this notebook, and it's running through the steps there. Let me just take you a little, another one of the links that we've got in the show notes is just the link over to where you can do this yourself. It's got some basic instructions. They're pretty straightforward. Let you know that you can just go ahead and get the PowerShell module you'll need to run this command, the invoke execute notebook is inside of here. And then you can actually go ahead and download this notebook with PowerShell, of course. And then all you need is this one little command, which is basically what I'm doing right here. And this allows you to pass in those parameters so that you can pass in whatever you want for your SA password and make it for whatever your port number is and let you go on from there.
Aaron, this is pretty cool. So it seems like this is kind of like the ability to do PowerShell scripting like you would have a script, pass parameters, except now you can do it with a notebook, which allows you some more maybe deeper error tracing or just a more detailed type of report. Is that kind of what I'm getting?
That's right. So in addition to just being able to execute the notebook and get the results back, what you're also going to be able to see is inside of a notebook, it's going to save an output notebook that has everything so that you can go back and later on verify that everything went right. As you can see right now, the demo that I was running, it failed. I'm just going to go right ahead and see if I can run it again and see if it'll work the second time. But there it goes. It looks like it actually worked that time. When it gets done, all those results are saved into an output notebook, and I can go ahead and pull that up and take a look at it. You know, if like a week later, I need to go back. You know, as you saw down there, is 26 different steps inside that notebook. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, did 24 get done? You know, I don't remember it. You know, it was a week ago, 2 weeks ago, I moved on to other stuff. Right. I don't remember. And that's the great thing about a notebook. You go pop it open and tells you right there whether that step got completed successfully or if there's an error, like I got the first time. It's right there in the error message inside yourself. So all your documentation right there.
Very cool. And, you know, Aaron, when we think about this, why do you think it's important for people to know about this?
It's because, you know, the popularity of notebooks is definitely out there. And you might be saying, well, I've got a script. You know, why do I really need to do anything more than this? You know, well, it's when you come back and you want to work with it again. But then I don't know about you, but I've had the situation where I've got one script, but then I copy it and make it slightly different. And then I copy it again and make it slightly different. And then I copy it again and make it slightly different, right? Right. And then I've got all these different versions laying around. With this, I can, you know, have a really good incentive to tighten those reins back down a little bit, being able to parameterize a few things and be able to use maybe just one version of the script. That's actually what I'm down to for building, when it comes to building, you know, a Docker container, one script, whether I'm building it on my machine, on someone else's machine, on a machine up in Azure. I've just got this one notebook that I use, and I don't have to remember all these different places where the different versions are. All the documentation is inside the notebook.
Yeah, no, I really like it. I hadn't seen this before, so I'll have to play with it myself. Was there anything else you wanted to show us today?
Yeah, definitely. I've got one more demo for you. I was doing, you know, a quick little on-prem demo for you of just how to build out, you know, my test containers. They're all working right now. So they're up and running. And just to give you a little lay of the land on those, they not only spin up SQL Server on a Linux container, but they will also go ahead and download and restore the AdventureWorks 2016 database for you. That's just an example so that you can take this script and use it as a template to, you know, download a backup out of your, you know, wherever your repo is, and maybe restore it into your environment as like a dev instance, right? Just to give you a template to work with that will make it easy step by step of how to do that. So next up, I want to show you one for working with data up in the cloud. And in this one, we'll take a look at, has a bunch of Power BI assets that I want to take, and I want to go ahead and move them into, into an Excel workbook that I want to basically scrape up all my data governance information. And just to give you a quick look at it here, we're going to be up in Power BI. I've got this Power BI tenant. It's got some workspaces in there. Some of these workspaces have their reports inside of them and their data sets. And I want to go ahead and scrape all that information and store it somewhere for data governance reasons. The really, really cool thing here is that I can use not only a PowerShell notebook to get this information, but using that same technique, what I can do is I can go ahead and log in using the login-power BI commandlet, connect to my tenant, once I'm authenticated through, then I can just go ahead and execute this command that is super long, but executes that notebook and executes and not only tells it to execute, but also store the results into another notebook for results. And I'll go ahead and kick that off right now so we can get that running. And all that's done without having to make me re-authenticate, right? I only come in, I did login -Power BI right before we started filming a few minutes ago. And now it's still retained that login and it's able to connect, use that notebook, go grab that information and start stuffing it into my output for me. Okay, and as you can see, I've already run in this notebook once before. So let's go ahead and take a look at those results that came out of my tenant. So I've got an Excel file that should have all my information that I need with everything from this notebook that ran, all those lines of code that executed. So here we're working with my workspaces. Here are their IDs. Here are the names of those workspaces. We can take a look further down, the data sets and the reports within those workspaces. So now I've just gone through and collected all this information that I need for data governance reasons. And I've been able to extract that all, put it into a location. In this case, you know, I'm using Excel for a demo, but I could have just as easily written this to, you know, an Azure SQL database or something else and stored the results there.
Wow, this is pretty powerful. I mean, you kind of open up the doors of opportunities here where we're not just dealing with Azure SQL database or SQL server, but also leveraging the power of PowerShell, no pun intended. We can kind of do things with Power BI as well or other services that have PowerShell enabled. So I think it's really interesting to show people like think outside the box of what's possible when you look at these PowerShell notebooks and parameterizations. You know, Aaron, as people kind of look at this video and want to get started, you know, what would be your advice?
So I've got quite a few assets out there. There's also assets built into Azure Data Studio to get you started. It's pretty easy. You know, start small, start, you know, with querying your own local database or something like that. And, you know, there's plenty of information out there in the docs file. And then just try it. There's plenty of community examples. I'm not the only one doing this. People are loving this. This solves a lot of different issues that we've been having for, you know, generations of IT workers. And, you know, go out there, check out the samples. People have got other better ideas than I've got. You know, I've just got some simple things here, but there's some other workbooks out there that you can test out. There's the best practices check from the Tiger team. There's all kinds of stuff out there. Check out something that meets what you're trying to do and give it a whirl. I bet you're going to love it.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much, Aaron, for coming on the show again. It was really useful for me, and I think our viewers are really going to enjoy it as well. If you like this video, go ahead and like this video, give us a subscribe, and leave us a comment and let us know what you're doing with parameterization. We hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.